In April 2012, Florence, Italy was the setting for a conference on scientific communication that brought together over 600 experts from around the world. We picked four of them and asked them all the same four questions. How should we talk to the public? Should we just relate the facts? Are some topics too difficult?
When are we successful?
This is what they had to say.
Old ways of science communication that were very much based on the I'm the scientist, I know best, I will tell you what you need to know. And I had an experience of that with working with the Royal Observatory Greenwich, and they were updating their astronomy galleries. And we got presented with a script for the galleries that said things like, you know, planets are very small and they don't really shine. And I tried to say, well, who's your audience going to be? Your audience is going to be very often kids with their parents. And for kids with their parents, mum and dad are big. And you can fit 6 billion mums and dads on this planet. So how on earth do you reach a kid by just saying, oh, planets are very small?
The GMO case, for example, you know, for several years, actors in the field thought they could apply this unilinear, paternalistic, top-down model to an issue that, by definition, since it was touching food, equity, diversity, globalization, patenting, you know, property rights, biodiversity, couldn't be amenable, you know, to a passive process.
I was recently reading something that one of my graduate students was writing, which was a research proposal about studying communication about biotechnology. And she had gone into this two-paragraph explanation of genetic code and genetics. And I thought, that's too much. Actually, for this audience, they really don't need to know that. It's not that it's talking down to them, it's that it's irrelevant.
I think when we're speaking with, rather than to, various different groups, it's about finding out what they want to know. And in many ways, it's about giving them the power to direct the conversation.
And I will say to people, look, this is my view, I can't prove it, but from the work that's coming across and what I can tell you about it, this is the way I think the research is going to go, this is the way I think the discoveries are going to go. And I'm absolutely confident that anybody I'm talking to will be able to factor in my own personal preferences.
I think there needs to be more of editorial, not just from science communicators, but from scientists too. Let's hear about their opinions. Let's hear about their thought processes. They're people just like everyone else.
If you communicate only the facts, you will fail. That's the first point. Now, does that mean editorializing or being subjective? That's not quite the same thing. I think that what we have to do is put information in those facts in a social context. Both the social context of how it's useful for the audience, but also the social context of how that knowledge came to be. What were the kinds of questions, the big conceptual questions that you were asking that led you to this kind of issue?
I would say the difficulty of the topic is one of a list of conditions. Of course, this would make more difficult for an issue to get on the front page of a newspaper. 1919, when the confirmation of relativity came, the New York Times and the Times in the US and in the UK had it on the front page, you know, revolution in science, Newtonian ideas overthrown. And Einstein commented that excitement and saying, I'm very surprised because there's probably a dozen people in the world who can understand the theory.
A lot of scientists are what I call splitters. They want to talk about the ifs, buts and wherefores of their science. Whereas most people are lumpers. We want to know the implications and we want to know, you know, the bigger picture of what that means, particularly the relevance to me personally or to my community about what something means. And you can do that with any science, with any research.
We're dealing with a general public that's used to getting a yes or no answer that is going to click on the web, and if it's not on the first page, they're not going to scroll through to the next page. They're not going to click through on the links. So we're dealing with an audience that is not looking for subtlety. I'm not sure that I know yet how to recommend that you speak in sound bites, as I'm not doing well enough at, and explain something complicated in a world where people are looking for really simple answers.
La, 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 la. If you buy into this narrow vision, you know, you have some problems because you define success by you know, people embracing a certain vision that GMOs are the best thing in the world, that nanotechnologies will solve any problems. So that's again very limited. But if you have a vision of science communication as a process, we immediately realize that this is a very important thing, at least in democratic society, that nobody, not even, you know, the most powerful actor is fully able to control the process of science communication, because it's an interactive process.
I think each of the players in a science communication activity have values that they bring and will have different measures of success. And to me, something that is successful is something that connects with those values and with as many of those different values as possible in achieving something that they thought was important.
Ultimately, what we want to do is engage people in a conversation. Do people come back for a conversation? Do they return to you or your organization or your subject to find out more?